Get started. Okay, so welcome everyone to today's Imagine seminar. Thanks a lot for joining. And it's my great pleasure to introduce Ottmar Scherzer, who is giving today's talk. Ottmar is a professor of mathematics at the University of Vienna. And he's also a group leader of the inverse problems in mathematical imaging group at RICAM in Linz, which is also in Austria. Ottmar has done several really seminal works, has made several seminal contributions to inverse problems, both on the more mathematical and in particular, I personally know Ottmar very well for all his work that he did on variational regularization. And he is also what is very, I think, exciting and I think makes his contributions interesting and far-reaching is that the work that he's doing is usually very tightly linked to concrete applications. And in particular, he's looking a lot at physics-based inverse problems, some of the work he's going to share with us today, which is his work on photoacoustic tomography. So I'll hand the word over to you, Ottmar, and I very much look forward to your presentation on reconstructions in coupled physics imaging.
Thank you very much, Carola, for the nice introduction. It's really a pleasure and an honor to give a presentation in this series. I also heard that Simon Erich just gave recently a talk on, probably I should have chosen a different title because he was the one who created this name in for a special issue in inverse problems. So this is then his presentation, I assume. But otherwise, anyway, I narrowed down a little bit the scope of this presentation because in the beginning, I thought, well, I could do a little bit wrap up of things which have been done. But actually, I realized that afterwards, this is too much and probably the words the whole talk gets not so focused. So I decided at the end to do focused photoacoustic imaging, and this is the special interest which I had for several years now. But let me briefly go back to coupled physics imaging, what it actually means and where photoacoustic imaging belongs to. So it's these are imaging techniques which became very popular and they use the interactions of at least two physical effects. I will later describe it in more detail what I mean by this, but it's not just something which is traditionally done, for instance, in optical imaging where you send in a light with a certain frequency and then you record the light which is transmitted to the specimen also with the same frequency. So here's really a coupling of physical effects going on. There have been reported several of them. I mentioned photoacoustic imaging already before. There's acousto-optics where something is excited acoustically and something is optically measured. The opposite, where something is optically excited and some acoustics is measured. But there are also things which I consider still as coupled physics imaging, which is this super resolution fluorescence microscopy, or the single molecule localization microscopy, where you load the molecules with some emitting particles, and then you turn them off and on with lasers. But typically all these chemical reactions which are going on are not modeled, but just the effect of this is observed. And this is also something which happens in photoacoustics. So let me briefly describe why I think these coupled physics techniques are useful. Some of you might have seen the left picture already. This is where photoacoustic tomography or photoacoustic imaging is considered to find its place. It's in between different other modalities like optical coherence tomography or diffusion optical tomography. So it's more or less in between in terms of resolution, which it can achieve, or in terms of specimen size. So, and I guess this is a particular feature of coupled physics imaging, that they can go beyond what certain modalities at the moment can do. So you can place them in terms of resolution or in terms of specimen size somehow in between existing techniques. So this this picture, which I have taken from this paper, from the OSA, which is already 2014, this was actually shows very drastically where this is located. They have expressed this in terms of mean free paths. If you transfer it to optical, the regime, you can see what you can resolve. This is an embryo chicken. And this is about 1.2 millimeters. So this is about the size of the object which you consider in photoacoustics tomography. You can go further up, of course, up to breast imaging, where it was originally invented for, but this is the kind of size of objects which we are looking at. And this means you can translate it in mean free paths, which is the path which it takes until an object is, until a particle is scattered. So these are the objects. This is something where you could apply it. This has been done in the medical university of Vienna. Actually, there should be a reference, but it was somehow deleted. This has been done by my colleague Wolfgang Drexler. He is an expert on optical coherence tomography, and he also combines this setup with photoacoustics. So optical coherence tomography is a scattering modality. So when you look in this, this is a palm of a human. If you look in, you see a lot of scattering. Each particle is scattering, and this is the reflected image. But looks more on the absorption of energy. So it in this case, it gives you the blood vessels which absorb more or less the energy and then result in an image. So also here, this shows the kind of applications which you could consider. You can go a few millimeters inside the skin, for instance, or in other things which are more or less near to the surface, up to centimeters, I would guess. So how Li Hong Wang describes this photoacoustic imaging. Li Hong Wang is the key expert in this field, experimentalist, and probably he stimulated all this exciting development. And in one of his articles, he calls this the method of lightning and thunder. So the thing which happens here is actually this transfer of energy. So first of all, he takes a laser impulse, excites the object, this is actually the energy which you bring into the body. So as soon as the energy gets into it, does something with the energy, and in this case, what it does, it transfers them into pressure waves, sound waves, and there you have to have a short laser impulse that it can react with an immediate expansion, and this expansion is then the effect to produce pressure waves, and once you have these pressure waves, they travel outside, and then they travel outside, and then they are measured. So this is the whole physical setup. consisting actually of two things. First of all, the excitation with optical, infrared, or if you use microwaves, then it's called thermoacoustics. But high frequency waves, which are shortly pulsed and then produce the sound waves in a second step. So this is why it calls it lightning and thunder. The lightning is the first step and the thunder is the second step. So this is actually, if you prescribe it now in terms of this in a small scheme. So first of all, you have something like light propagation or microwave propagation. There are a lot of inverse problems actually, and they are usually summarized under the name quantitative photoacoustic tomography. It's, you use equations for photon densities. And typically if you work with infrared light or with light. Then after this one, there's this thermodynamics effect, which is somehow relating the energy which is introduced by the light into sound waves. And then there's the acoustic part, which is the standard thing in photoacoustics that you only consider this one, so the acoustic part. Here you use equations of wave propagation. Thermodynamics is just a linear effect, so usually everything in terms of energy which comes into the medium is just multiplied by a factor, the so-called Grüneisen parameter, and this tells you how much energy is transferred into sound waves. So there have been many papers. I crossed this out on quantitative photoacoustic imaging, for instance by Guillaume Ball and Gunther Ullmann. It's first of all not a complete list. These are typically nonlinear inverse problems. I will not consider them in my talk. It became too complicated and too many things. There are also, Simon already probably mentioned these papers already in the last event. So these are also numerically tests. Here, these are probably more theoretical based work. So what I am considering is this photoacoustic imaging part, and at the end it will be a problem of integral geometry or an inverse problem of integral geometry talk at the end, but with some particular features. So let me briefly describe the mathematical part of photoacoustics. So really, don't misunderstand me, I only consider this part. So only the inverse problems for this part. So what I then do is I have to model the wave equation for the thunder. And typically I do it in, typically it has been done for several times, but not exclusively anymore in free space. So it's typically considered as a wave propagation in the full space Rn. Here you have the wave equation with a sound speed of the medium. And typically this is also assumed to be constant, at least in the beginning. And then you have source terms on the right-hand side. And the source terms is the thing which you want to really see afterwards. It's the, let's call it the converted electromagnetic energy. So the energy which is brought in by the laser inside the medium. And after that, including also the conversion parameter into sound waves. So it's what I consider here is Grüneisen times absorbed energy. And this is summarized in this parameter H. Then I take a notation which I'm probably not always consistent, but here I put in a delta distribution, actually the derivative of a delta distribution. And I consider this at the moment as a source term. So this is then the lightning. So I have a delta impulse, this delta impulse in time, this is the lightning. This is how much how strong the thunder will be. And this is then what I measure typically outside of the object. You can also reformulate this problem by Duhamel's principle or whatever you want to call it as an initial value problem. There are two things which come important. So you have an initial source, which is the, after all the all these chemical or chemical and physical processes which go on, go into, which are the absorbed energy multiplied by Grüneisen parameter. And this is a causality thing, so that there is no thunder coming into this object before the lightning has flashed. So this is the causality, and this is what you really want to see at the end. And this is actually what you see in these images before on this palm and all other things. When you show photoacoustics, usually you see exactly this reconstruction. So the inverse problems which we can consider, we have some manifold, and this is usually surrounding the object partly, or in ideally the full object is covered by some manifolds, and on this you put some sensors or some ingenious physical devices which can measure the pressure, like interferometry or something like this, which is much more difficult to implement. And then you try to reconstruct this function H. It probably started in the mathematical literature by these physical papers by Li Hong Wang, and at least in 2002, where certainly a boost could be observed in mathematics in this field, where he derived analytical back projection formulas for particular geometries like planar geometries, spherical geometries, and also in with line measurements. So it's measurements along lines. And now I guess you can find everything in terms of these in this reconstruction formulas in Peter Kutschmann's excellent book on the radon transform. I should also mention that there is also a lot of software available, and probably the best one, or the most prominent one and best one, is the K-Wave toolbox, which you can easily access and use for your own tests if you want to simulate these reconstruction formulas. So this is the kind of problems which we want to deal with. And the classical thing is that you have back projection formulas where you assume that C is constant, where you don't take into account all physical effects which are happening when you look for the pressure. So now I want to, after this introduction, I want to go a little bit into things which we did in particular and which are not following completely the standard model. So the first one is that sound speed variation play an important role in this kinds of reconstruction. So if you misestimate the sound speed, you will have a lot of artifacts to consider. So this is one part of my talk. Then I will consider something which is a little bit more speculative, is sectional imaging, that you try to look at certain images in certain regions in the image, in the 3D volume, because this is a possibility, at least mathematically. I have not seen it, and probably there's no chance to do it in this way practically, but at least it shows you what you have to do if you want to reconstruct sound speed and the absorption. And finally, if time allows, I will also show you a little bit what happens with acoustic attenuation if you want to take into account attenuation. So let us first start with the variable sound speed. So the equation is the same as before. So instead of using a constant sound speed, and I would like to add now a space-dependent sound speed parameter. Actually, I mentioned this before, I'm not completely consistent. I could put in here source terms as well, I was not so sure this if these are equivalent problems. So this, because the varying sound speed could make some problems. So this is why at the end I removed this and put it in as an initial condition, but I guess it should be fine. But the problem is the same. So we measure at some manifold surrounding the object of interest. We measure the pressure, and then we want to reconstruct, first of all, this H, later on also this C squared. And also this started very early, I guess, there's this interesting paper of Agranowski and Kutschmann, where there is uniqueness results proven very early at 2007. There are time reversal algorithms. Then there is this work of Stefanov and Ullmann, which I will make heavy use of. And then there's also something in the physics literature where it's a little bit different, because it's not an inversion, but it's there's also some correction of the acoustic speed variations. So now this is our problem, and now it comes to something which Martin Hanke always says, this Linz people always formulate it as an operator equation. And I do exactly what Linz people are expected to. I formulate it as an operator equation. So this is now the problem which I'm considering. If you know this, this is the initial condition. So this is this H in the wave equation. I assume it has some compact support in a domain omega, like for instance here. So otherwise here it's either zero or something homogeneous, which I can subtract, but let's assume it's zero. Here's the manifold where I measure, and as it was standard before, I consider it in free space. So the operator L is now this mapping this H onto the solution of the wave equation in free space. And from there, I take the trace which gives on the manifold, which gives my measurement data. And then it's a linear inverse problem. So I want to just reconstruct this H from, if I formulate it as an operator equation, L, this linear operator applied to H, gives me my measurement data. And then this is the classical Landweber or steepest descent algorithm with a certain damping parameter, which we usually keep fixed. And then we look at this Landweber iteration and show what it can achieve. So actually, when you do this, you need in the Landweber iteration, which is certainly the complication here, you need an adjoint operator. And this is certainly the tricky part in terms of numerical implementation, because if you do it in the continuous setting, so for function spaces, what this adjoint actually is, it's a transmission problem. So you solve the wave equation outside of the manifold. So the manifold is somehow a singularity. You have some zero initial data. Initial means in this case you solve the wave equation from time t to zero, but still consider this as an initial data. And then you have transmission conditions. And numerically, the annoying thing is, or the complicated thing, is that you have this input data from the residuum, which enters exactly at the interface. And this provides a jump from the inside and outside of the solution of the equation. And then you have to do a scaling and do a smoothing. But this is the most essential thing which you have to do. So the good thing about this method, the price to pay is to have this complicated adjoint, but the analysis is more or less straightforward. You can apply classical results from Jacques Kreutz, And if you have noise-free data, it immediately tells you that the land wave iteration is converging. If the if you have some noise and you stop with the discrepancy principle, meaning that you choose the first index such that the residuum, the largest index such that the discrepancy is still larger than the noise level, then this provides you a good approximation of the solution which you want to reconstruct. And this is the minimum known solution. So this is really from classical regularization theory, you get convergence. It's a straightforward application. Now let me go back to these alternatives which existed much earlier before. So there's this famous method of time reversal. And time reversal was introduced by Matthias Fink. There's also a very interesting and easy to read article in Scientific American, I think about at the millennium around. So it's very interesting where these methods have all been applied. And also my colleagues from Linz implemented stuff like this. So what this time reversal does is actually it's in terms, there's a philosophical break now because we have to consider this wave equation on a bounded domain. Other than that, we solve the equation just on the interior domain or half space you can also use. Then you have the same initial conditions as we had, also restricted on the half domain, but instead of using the transmission data from inside and outside and compare inside and outside, here you just use the measurement data. So actually the time reversal in our case gives us just an approximation of this age. And this is actually just solving this equation on a bounded domain, but using for this age the data which you have collected. So it's of course much easier. You don't need to worry about numerics between inside, outside domains. Let's see what comes out. Stefanov and Ullmann, actually you also used a sort of time reversal algorithm, and this is mathematics based, so it's definitely accurate. It gives you the solution which you really want. If you compare it with the previous one, actually this C squared should not be here. Here you solve again the wave equation, again in a bounded domain. You have some initial conditions initial conditions in the sense which I explained before, but there is an inhomogeneity coming up. And this inhomogeneity comes from the measurement data. So here again, more or less you use the measurement data. Here you prolongate the measurement data inside the domain omega, but only at the final stage. And this gives us this operator L tilde, which is here. And actually then to get this reconstruction formula, you use exactly this formula. So this is a little bit mathematically, of course, much more challenging. You have the composition of two operators. You prove that it can be computed as an identity operator where you subtract the compact operator. And then you construct the Neumann series. If you, for instance, look at M is equal to zero, then this is more or less time reversal. The only thing is that at the final stage, you propagate the solution inside to get some appropriate initial conditions. So this is the most probably the thing which you have to think of when you want to compare it with Fink's time reversal algorithm. So here is some test data which we have generated, and just to show you what you should expect when you apply these different techniques. So this is our image which we want to reconstruct. We don't do it in R3, but we do it in R2. So it's the ghosts. Then there is some. This is the one, the c squared of x. So this is the sound speed. In the equation, you have 1 over c squared. There you have two different cases which we considered. One of them is non-trapping, which means that for every point inside, a sound wave is propagating to a detector outside. So typically inside, this is trapped. So here it means that, unfortunately, I pressed the wrong button. So here, if there's a point, there must be a sound wave which travels to a detector here. And if this does not happen, if the sound is trapped, then there is a point inside here which does not travel to the boundary. And for this, at some point we calculated this, for this point you have a trapping at least inside here. So this is the difference. There's a minimal time that L is injective. So it's the same argument as I said before. So for every point inside, it takes some time to travel to a detector. So here, for instance, a wave travels from here to here. That's the minimal time that all information has passed to a detector. And if you don't have this time, so if you would stop before, then information from here cannot travel outside. So this is, it's recommended to not use this T0 as the immediate time to make measurements. So you should make a little bit more. Here we somehow did four times this initial time. And and here you see some different, this is not trapped example. So you see that time reversal behaves very good actually. Neumann series and Landweber produce similar things. Landweber is always the slowest. Neumann series is always faster. And time reversal is of course the fastest if it works. So if you reduce the recording time, then time reversal gets pretty bad. Neumann series and Landweber behave very well. Again, Landweber is slower. Here's a trapping speed, and this is actually a trapped particle. So here you see that you Landweber behaves a little bit better. So one says, this is for the trapped example, that Landweber behaves a little bit better, and we have chosen here the visually best reconstructions in between Neumann series and Landweber. So just to compare them, there are other comparisons made in the paper which should make it equally balanced. But as usual, the picture is the same. Landweber and Neumann series behave very well, but Landweber is much slower. So now let me briefly, I'm a little bit over time, so let me briefly check what sectional imaging is. Sectional imaging is something which tries to focus onto a certain plane in the 3D imaging, and then do in 2D inversions. It has been proposed, I don't know how successful it really is, but it reduces to quite some interesting mathematical problems. This is a typical picture a long time ago produced by my colleagues from Graz. This is actually when it is not a tick, actually, what you might expect. It's actually a fish. And what you see here is these are the fins, and these are eventually the eyes of the fish. It's always recorded with some detectors which look just on particular slices of this fish. The reconstruction now gets very similar. It's the wave equation is now somehow can be modeled. At least this is what we did in this paper. We put some focus on the axial direction, so in z direction. This is why we put here delta distribution. This is a two-dimensional function on the plane. And the question then is how to reconstruct this function h. And actually, because we do it in 3D, we want to reconstruct the three-dimensional functions for all plane images and for all depths which we are considering. And there are also black projection formulas, so you can do this like with standard things. I must mention that here there is, at this point in this paper, there is no variation in the sound speed. So the sound speed is constant. But the thing what we wanted to make use of it afterwards was to do some tomographic sectional imaging. And the trick actually is now that we simulate all possible planes. So like in tomographic imaging, we rotate all the possible planes, focus to these planes, and then we try to reconstruct this function h. But in this case, we produce such a lot of data that we also think of reconstructing this c squared. So we want to reconstruct this in parallel. So I will rush to this quickly. It's just based on Born approximation. So you can split the pressure wave into two waves. Some of one which is inhomogeneous, this is the update, and the one which is homogeneous but inhomogeneous in the initial conditions. More or less you get a reconstruction formula, not completely explicit, but you can resolve this from the measurement data. You can resolve the product of h and the Volterra integral operator, and somehow you can split this product because the Radon transform can be inverted into these two components, and from these you can filter out actually the two components, but still there's a Volterra operator involved where you don't have an analytical reconstruction formula. But more or less, in principle, it's possible, but of course, technically, this is a nightmare because rotating the experiments in photoacoustics or rotating the experimental setup is not something which practitioners want to do. So conclusion on the sound speed, the sound speed variations lead to significant distortions in the reconstructions. In the worst case, it could be trapping, and then you can somehow see that you cannot reconstruct everything. What I observed is from all these numerical algorithms, they have some time reversal effects in there, either very simple ones or more complicated ones, but essentially all of them behave like time reversal. And of course, you can use it to reconstruct both. Let me briefly, I'm have probably to rush a little bit, the thing in attenuation in photoacoustics. So this is a very similar topic. Every sound wave is damped when it progresses. So, and you know that there's a frequency dependence. Usually when you live in an apartment and you have students next to you, you know they have this low frequency sounds when they make a party which travels through the whole building. But the low frequency parts you don't hear, and this is why it gets so annoying. A similar thing is also here. So you have, whenever you consider pressure waves, you have to you take into account that they are damped, and they are frequency damped. And this is actually comes from the imaginary part of a pseudo-differential operator. This is this imaginary part of this kappa, which I which is more or less a Fourier operator in frequency domain. So if you take, for instance, just to see, if you take this kappa squared minus omega squared, then this is just a classical wave equation without attenuation. Before we go to this reconstruction formulas, which I want to show you, or the results which I want to show you, the good thing is we consider everything in the free space. In this case, it's free space in R3, and for the solution of the wave equation, which is written down, the solution of the wave equation, which is here, you get an explicit solution, and the explicit solution is this Green's Green's function, this kernel here, and here is just this kappa of omega. This is the term which causes the attenuation, and if you multiply it by this initial condition, you get the solution, well, in Fourier domain, but doesn't matter too much. So at the end, what I will do is what we did is we don't consider this solution operator, but we consider it without this minus I omega. So whatever I will study is not the solution operator, but I will consider this inverse Fourier operator of H, but with excluding these terms. And this means I don't consider the wave equation itself, but I consider the solution, which is time integrated. And this seems to be necessary to do what for the analysis which we do afterwards. Now, when you look at this operator AK, how it's really defined, you have to find some spaces where you do it, and you do it in the space of Tampa distributions. And actually, that's very crucial to do it. And you have to make sure that it maps Tampa distributions to Tampa distributions. And in formal terms, it actually means that if you have two test functions and you apply the Fourier operator to this one, where this kappa squared enters as a multiplication, still makes it well defined. So this U should be a Tampa distribution, and then this AKU should be as well. And this is the formal definition. So everything is defined via weak forms, but this is a central condition. So we have to make sure that at least this equation which we are considering is defined in a reasonable function space setting. And now this comes very abstract. It tells you what we have to assume on these functions. It's called an attenuation coefficient. If this growth rate holds, then there comes something like continuous continuation of this operator, of this function K, from the upper half plane to the upper half plane. And this has to satisfy, again, such a growth condition, and it has to be symmetric. So this is very crude mathematics. I mean, it's just usually, overloads everyone, but actually it's very natural. I mean, it tells you that if the operator has to be well defined, so it has to map, if you have a function in Schwarz space and you apply the test the weak formulation, then this has to be again in Schwarz space. So this is the usual thing, otherwise the operator would not be well defined, and it has to be causal. So this means that if you initialize the wave equation, it should not have an input before time zero, and it should map real value distributions. We only have real valued functions when we apply this thing to real world functions. So this is the translation of these three conditions. They are equivalent. It means exactly this one. And it pops up in many other things where dispersive electromagnetic wave come. Let me just show there's another thing which is important, which is the finite speed of propagation. I think if if the wave speed is finite dimensional, then it should behave like a wave equation. And this is again manifested in a very nasty condition that the holomorphic extension of the law which you actually have has a finite limit if you go with the frequency to infinite. But this is actually the number which gives you a finite speed. And this is a formal definition how a finite speed looks like. Okay, just briefly, and I'm very much at the end. I think I have to very much stop at the end. So the imaginary part is, this is how we differ between the attenuation coefficients. If something is like behaving like a power law, then the imaginary part has this, is below a certain power, then we call it strong attenuation coefficient. And if it more or less behaves like without attenuation, plus a perturbation for the attenuation, which is just a number, and a small perturbation, then we call it weak attenuation coefficient. So, and this is just different models which I scan through. So this is the thermoviscous model, very famous. You have to check if the holomorphic extension maps this part onto the upper part, and this is what we visualized in this formula. Thermoviscous model in the literature is strongly attenuating in our definition. A model which we developed, which is based on the thermoviscous model, is also strongly attenuating. They only differ here by the exponents, by the root which you take. The power law from Szabo, which is also very famous, but it's not the one which has causality, so it's not causal in general. But if you modify it a little bit, so you add here a certain factor, then you get a causal extension. It's also strongly attenuating. And modified Szabo's model also with some attenuation factor, but only you perturb a little bit the model which was originally. For instance, this one was not there. And the most interesting for me has been developed by Nachman, and this is the one which is the only one which is famous in the literature which has a weak attenuation coefficient. So this one behaves here more or less. It has a slope which is tangential. So I don't go into the detail. I just show you the end, what comes out, because I'm a little bit over time. So the thing what happens if you look at strongly attenuating media, what you get is that you have an operator which you remember is not the classical photoacoustic operator with attenuation. It would be the one where you integrate over the time. And in this case, what you see is if you have a strong attenuation coefficient, the eigenvalues decay exponentially. So this more or less tells you that this is not really a wave equation anymore. It's more or less behaving, I would say it behaves more like a diffusion process. And this is the reason is if this strong attenuation coefficients hold. So on the other hand, if you look at the weak attenuation coefficient, then it behaves, the singular values behave like n to the minus 2 over third. So this is what you would expect actually also from a standard wave equation where you have no attenuation. If it's weak in our sense, that it's more or less just a small perturbation of the standard wave equation, then it behaves like a wave equation. There's a similar result in Palamudov, which was for the standard wave equation. Here it's then for the attenuated wave equation. So the proofs are really lengthy. So this is something which is not easy to do, but at the end you get something which you also see from the radon transform in general. You have some decay rate of the spectral volumes. So attenuation is very interesting for me because all the engineering models which are there behave like strong attenuating media, and probably they cannot really be inverted. If you consider it purely mathematically. The one which was really derived by Adrian Nachman is a fantastic modeling achievement. He has actually generalized this as well. But this is actually the model which if I would start and choosing one for practical applications, which I would use. And I also think that the modeling is so good that you can really interpret this model. On the other hand, there's a practical gap, which I should also mention, that the power, these models are all determined for a limited frequency range. So photoacoustics is what measured is always measured for some in some frequency range, which is actually not that big. Well, for mathematicians, it's not that big. But so there is certainly another problem which one has to deal when one looks for reconstruction formulas is that, first of all, the power law models which you are using are always loosed in a limited frequency range. And also the inversion should be take place in a limited frequency range. Okay, so with this, I would like to stop. I mean, it was a little bit over time. I hope not too much. And I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Otmar. So I'm sorry I got in right after the beginning of your talk because I got confused with the time shift.
You are not alone with the confusion.
No way to do reverse time to get back on time. Anyway, thank you for your talk. It was very interesting. And the floor is open for questions. If anybody has a question, please feel free to raise your hand and we can unmute you so you can ask your question directly. So I'll check in the chat box, but I don't think there is any question up for now. So, okay, there is one popping up. This is a question from Mathias Louboutin. Would you like to be unmuted, Mathias, if I find you? Mathias, where are you? Emma. Actually, I'm not sure I can do that myself. So actually, I read your question and hopefully we'll be able to unmute you by then. So your question was, how does these Landweber iterations compare to data simulation methods, such as back and forth nudging that have looser constraints on the measurements?
So all what I know from data simulation, which is not a lot, these are different terms which you're using, but in principle it should be more or less the same, I guess. I'm not completely sure. I have read recently a paper by Botthast and one of his co-workers, and it seems that they are really, at least I would say, close to be on the safe side. But honestly, I have never investigated, aside from reading these papers, I have never checked whether they are identical or not. But I think there's a strong relation.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Matthias. Further questions? Well, in the meanwhile, I have a very naive one, maybe. What you mentioned about the form of the attenuation laws is somewhat related to, or the corresponding thing in electromagnetics would be what is the form of the permittivity and permeability, and how does it depend on frequency? So I guess you're looking for something akin to Drude or Drude-Lorentz models for the frequency dependent on the sound speed, right?
Yeah. I mean, I'm not so familiar with this electromagnetic things. I have this paper. I have just looked at it recently, which I was citing. But it's actually really the same effect, I guess. And mathematically, it reduces to the same problems or the same nice mathematics which we also observe. But it's really something which comes in as a, well, I mean, it's still something which I would formulate in the frequency domain, because this is where it's measured.
Okay. And so in a weak attenuation case, is there any hope that you could that a time reversal based method could be used also?
I think so. I mean, first of all, you have to make I would say pretty sure that it can be used actually in the weak things. Also the pure time reversal would give you already good results, so I'm pretty sure it would work. And of course, if you know the model which you I think can estimate at least in a certain frequency range you can measure, even then you can use all the other techniques probably. I mean, definitely the Landweber would work. And I would expect that also the classical time reversal would work.
Okay.
I think it would be interesting also to look at it at the point of microlocal analysis, because I would expect that they have the same behavior with the standard wave equation. And this would mean probably that you can reconstruct the same singularities in the data, at least.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. We have a question from Tram. Tram, you're unmuted if you want to ask a question.
So thank you very much. So thank you very much for your nice talk. I hope that you could hear me. So
I can hear you now.
The time reversed method has required some conditions for convergence analysis in comparison to the classical regularization method, like you mentioned, for instance, Landweber.
Yeah, they are a little bit different. Yeah. I mean, you can see partly of it. It's actually in the problem formulation. So Landweber can deal with data errors, and here, if you need to backpropagate the data which you measure at the boundary, you have to have a certain smoothness. So this is actually inherent in the problem formulation. Maybe I can go back. I don't know if this works. Yeah. For instance, here you have to have enough smoothness to prolongate the data, because this is even more pronounced in the classical time reversal, because you have to make sure that this equation is in some function space well defined. This is not such a problem if you go to this. Go to the iterative process, because you don't apply it to the measurement data directly. So you need different assumptions on the measurement data, for instance. And this probably means that here you need to do in time reversal, you need to do a pre-smoothing of this H. Otherwise, you cannot apply this. So yes, the answer is you need different assumptions. Yeah. And also, what you don't have, but I mean, this is not, I would not say this is a big drawback, but but here it's in here you don't take into account measurement errors. So there's no need to use a discrepancy principle for stopping, which can be a benefit or a disadvantage, of course. Was this somehow your question or?
Yes, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you, Tran, for your question. Any other questions or comments? Please feel free to raise your hand or put a word in the chat box. Somebody has raised his hand. Let's see. I'm still scanning through the list of people. Anybody wants to ask a question? Carlos, you're online.
Hi, thank you very much for the talk, Otmar. I have a question to see if you know how does this algorithms reconstructions compare to say the optimization methods that are proposed in many papers by say Mark Anastasio and Li Hong Wang. So yeah. They discretize the problem way before. So so they have some advantages on the modeling side. So I wanted to hear your comments on that side as well. Thank you.
I know some of the papers. I didn't want to use to talk about variational methods because this would get too much. I mean, I would do that. I was already over time. In principle, whenever I do something like this Landwehr iteration, then I can do also in parallel a variational method. So this is more or less that they use the same features. I have a little bit more flexibility. I guess this is what you're referring to. If I would, for instance, use the kind of regularizer. So if I would use total variation minimization or something like this, then I cannot use it with this time reversal. But it has benefits and disadvantages. I actually was looking for the older references with time reversal to understand how this works, what can be really reconstructed. And then I wanted to compare it with with other iterative methods, but I completely agree. You can also use all kinds of variational methods. Some of them have real benefits against this one. If you think of total variation minimization, I'm pretty sure it behaves much better than all these kinds of algorithm when you reconstruct piecewise constant parameters. So depending on the equations which you look at, it's variational methods have a big benefit. One must say one thing, which is, I guess, speaking against variational methods and also probably against these Landwehr iterations, that they are too slow for practical applications, at least at the moment. So whatever we implement is usually based on back projection, because this back projection is so fast and it can be done more or less. It's still not real time, but in a few, I don't say a time now, but close to real time, you get a reconstruction for real data. And this is my experience with the practical things. We can do many, we can develop many of these algorithms, but currently the standard is back projection algorithms based on fast Fourier methods. And they also can be done on graphics card, which is another advantage. So I think the practical side is really back projection formulas, these fantastic mathematical formulas, and all these other things probably will come at a later stage, but not now.
All right, thank you so much.
Did this answer a little bit? Or did, I mean, we can talk offline if you have more questions, of course.
All right. I'm looking at further questions, but I think the audience is not that curious anymore. Well, in any case, Otmar, many thanks for your talk. It was very nice. And we look forward to further development of photoacoustics. And we look also forward to seeing all of you next week for our next Imagine seminar. And thank you all for joining today. And thanks again, Otmar, for a very nice talk.
Thanks again, Eric, for the invitation.